council regular meeting. And before we begin, we'll do a roll call. Irving?
Chair Linda Lopez.
Here.
Vice Chair Rafael Ambidanio.
Present.
Councilmember Laura Kaplan.
Here.
Councilmember Beatrice Cerillo.
Here.
Councilmember Mary Martinez.
Present.
Councilmember Dale Miller. Councilmember Everardo Rodriguez.
Here.
Councilmember Esperanza Vasquez.
Present.
Youth Member Diane Zarmenio.
Here.
Alternate Youth Member Emily Cordova.
Here.
Okay, thank you, Irving. Okay, we have a public comment on our agenda. If there's anyone who'd like to make comment on any issue, topic that's not on tonight's agenda. And if you do want to make a comment, I ask you that you complete one of the speaker slips that's on the back table there. I have Oscar, there's no last name. Oscar Sanchez from Barron Avenue. Oscar, did you have a comment you want to make? Can you come up to this microphone right over here?
Buenas tardes.
Good
afternoon in English. She's gonna help me. Nosotros tenemos un pequeño problema. Bueno, va a ser pequeño problema para ustedes, pero nosotros que estamos en la situación es un gran problema.
So we have what might seem like a small problem to you, but it's a really big problem for us.
Nosotros vivimos en 855 Barron Avenue en las trailers que están aquí cerquitas en la escuela de Ferox.
We live in the trailer park at 855 Barron Avenue near Fair Oaks Elementary School.
Hay alrededor 50 unidades de trailers y alrededor de algunos 150 niños y muchas familias ahí que podemos perder el lugar si es que no recibimos una ayuda del gobierno, del condado, de alguien.
There's about 50 units with over 150 kids that live in that space, and if we don't receive some sort of help from the government or somebody, it's possible that we will no longer be able to stay there.
Esperamos que por recibir la ayuda que ya ayer tuvimos un pequeño una reunión con Erwin y a los de Rebuilding Together y pero se necesitan los resources para que nos ayuden a resolver el problema que tenemos.
We had a small meeting with Irving and Rebuilding Together this week, but we do need more resources to be able to stay there and resolve this problem.
Les pedimos que nos ayuden, ¿verdad? De parte del condado, andamos tocando muchas puertas y al parecer sí estamos teniendo pues algunos resultados con el condado. No sé, vamos a seguir tocando más puertas hasta no alcanzar las metas que queremos de que nuestras familias no se desintegren.
We've been knocking on a lot of doors looking for help, and we've received some help from the county, and we're hoping that you guys will be able to help us.
Específicamente, ¿qué es el problema?
Nosotros tenemos las 50 unidades, el 99% están en un espacio ilegal de acuerdo a la ciudad, a las regulaciones de la ciudad.
About 99% of the units in this trailer park have illegal add-ons, or I guess additions, that are not according to the county's ordinance or law.
Las trailers se situaron ahí hace 30, 40 años donde no había regulaciones, pero hoy hay regulaciones nuevas y las cuales tenemos que hacerles un upgrade.
Yeah, so the The trailers have had these illegal add-ons for over 30 or 40 years, but now the ordinance or the laws are being enforced, so they need to figure out how to remove them.
Okay, señor, nomás tienes dos minutos para hablar y tenemos más gente que quieren hablar.
Oh.
No vamos a hacer acción en este problema, sobre este problema hoy, pero queremos discutir con Supervisor Slocum, con la oficina de Supervisor Slocum, porque tú ya junto con ellos, ¿que no?
Sí.
Sí, okay. Sí. So necesitamos discutir y necesitamos más información sobre ese problema. Pero gracias para tu tiempo y vamos a con otra persona.
Okay. Muchas gracias por su tiempo. Sí. Me pongo un poco nervioso porque nunca estoy entre tanta gente tan honorable como ustedes.
He says thank you for your time and I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to speak here. And just for those of you, Linda just reminded him he had 2 minutes to share his concerns, and she said that we won't be taking action on this item this evening, but they will be speaking with supervisor's office to get more information.
Because he had already met with them, so, and we don't know what that conversation was. Okay. And Oscar Sanchez, tengo tu información aquí. Gracias, señor. Okay, Jeff Norris, he works for the county. I saw the county center address on there.
Yes, thank you for allowing me to speak tonight. Good evening, I'm Jeff Norris. I am one of the district coordinators with the Sheriff's Office of Emergency Services. The Office of Emergency Services is very concerned about the safety of the whole community, everybody. And as we go into our fourth year of a drought, we are now looking at an above average rainfall winter. There's great concerns about flooding, and the Office of Emergency Services is studying areas that are prone to flood, and if it is the desire of this council, we'd be happy to present at a later date information about what the probabilities of flooding are and how, if it became necessary, evacuations could be done to protect the public. I invite any member of the council, or for that matter, any member of the community who has concerns about safety, to contact us at the Office of Emergency Services. I'd be more than happy to do anything I can to get you the answers that you need.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much, Mr. Norris.
Thank you.
Okay, we have Aurora Gallardo from Regent. Oh, Star Vista.
Yes.
Oh, that's a charter school?
No, that's a nonprofit organization.
Oh,
yes.
Oh, got it. Yeah.
Yes, and I brought. Yes. Hi, everyone. This is really exciting. I'm a little bit nervous.
Aurora, you
yes.
Have 2 minutes.
I know. Really quick. Again, so my name is Aurora Gallardo, and I am the new community worker here for the area North Fair Oaks, working with families that have a child under 5. My introduction is going to be more than 2 minutes, but I did bring a little, flyer that says all the information and the services that we provide in this community. Okay? Nice to meet you guys.
Okay, thank you. Okay, no other public comment. So we have minutes from July 23rd, and if there is a motion to approve the minutes, or if there's any changes or amendments. Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
I move to approve the North Fair Oaks Community Council meeting minutes for the Thursday, July 22nd, 2015.
I second the motion for approving the minutes for Thursday. Thursday, July 23rd.
Okay.
2015.
Oh, that's where that, okay. Okay, there's a motion to approve. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye?
Aye.
Any opposed? No? Yes, sir.
No.
Oh, excuse me. Okay. Oh, okay, okay. Okay, we have a request to move an agenda item. So, California Highway Patrol report. Hello.
Hi, good evening, members of the council. Mr. Callaghi, Mr. Torres, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here and an honor to have the Highway Patrol serve members of the North Fair Oaks community and the council. For this past quarter's report, I just wanted to report briefly on a little bit of what we've been doing to try to address the accident statistics in the area. Fortunately, we've seen a slight decrease from where we've been for the previous years. For the North Fair Oaks community, year to date, we're at 44 collisions, and those are property damage, with the exception of 5 collisions that did involve some semblance of injury, but that's down from 46 and 57, which is where we're at in 2013. So the good news is we're trending in the right direction. However, it still shows that there's significant room for improvement. And one of the things that we've been doing is, in addition to the CHP patrols, that we've been working collaboratively with the county's saturated traffic enforcement program, which is where agencies from throughout San Mateo County will come in to various communities on a rotational basis and have a very strong presence in regards to traffic enforcement. It's not about how many citations we put forth or how many verbal warnings, but it's about having that presence in the community and serve as an educational tool to really let the residents and the people who work in this community see that we're out there, and hopefully it causes people to drive more safely, put down the cell phones, put on the seat belts, all the things that we want to see happen to prevent accidents and to save lives and prevent injuries. And so in that regard, we've been working very closely with members of the San Mateo County Sheriff's Office as well to provide the highest level of service to the members of this community and improve the quality of life for everyone who works and resides here in the North Fair Oaks community. And some of the other ways that we do that is through our engagement and other programs, such as the Bicycle Rodeo, which we had engaged in recently, as well as earlier this month, we did a child safety seat event here at the North Fair Oaks community on a Saturday. We had nearly 50 people from the community who came to have child safety seats installed. If they didn't have seats and there was a demonstrated need, then we provided them with the seats, and we showed them how to safely put those in so that their children were properly restrained. If they're not in there safely or if they're not in there correctly, it really does no good. So it was one of the outreach components that we reached out to the community to do. And also, I'm very pleased and proud to say that we're a partner of the California Highway Patrol in the North Fair Oaks Community Parade. It's a tremendous event, and again, it shows us really the value of what North Fair Oaks has to offer for everybody. And it's an amazing outpouring of support from local businesses to residents to people within the community. And again, and I couldn't be prouder than to have the men and women of my department to be able to be a participant and a partner in that, to provide all of you, again, the highest level of safety and service. And I'll now entertain any questions from the council, should they have any.
Any questions? No, I think we're good. Thank you very much.
All right, well, thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you. So we're gonna follow next with the Sheriff's Department report. And I think that's the only change on the agenda going forward.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the council, Mr. Callaghi, Mr. Torres. Highlights from the second quarter. In reviewing the crime-related activities in the North Fair Oaks area, there was a decrease in reported crime activity. Burglaries, both residential and automobile, were significantly lower. While there was an overall decrease in reported crimes, there was an increase in robberies. There were 9 this quarter as opposed to 7 last quarter. We continue to actively patrol the North Fair Oaks area and have made numerous arrests and written even more traffic citations. In regards to parking enforcement, we continue to enforce the parking regulations and have written numerous citations in the quarter. In recent months, we have seen an increase in personal robberies, which is also known as street robberies. We're asking people to be aware of their surroundings and for residents and business owners to call in any suspicious activity. And we have prepared a community advisement that defines personal robbery and provides tips for personal safety and what to do if you're the victim of a robbery. And that's been provided to the council. Do you have any questions?
Any questions?
What is the community advisement?
It's an advisement that that shows tips and what to do if you're the victim of a robbery. Things like not walking by yourself, not carrying large sums of money, and not showing, like, when you're walking with your cell phone, not to have it out, and then what to do if you're the victim of a robbery, you know, how to call us and how to report and get the suspect information as well.
Is there a way to put that into the digital media, like?
Yes, and
site for the sheriff's department.
And that was also done. We've provided this handout, cool. And it's on our social media page as well.
That's great.
Yeah, and it's also been provided in Spanish. So.
Awesome.
Yeah. It'd be good to get this in a little like something smaller that people can, like, you know what I'm saying?
Yes,
like,
and
little,
there's
like a little cheat sheet or something.
Right,
you know?
And there's a lot of information on the page.
Yeah, it's a lot of, it's wordy. It's good information, mm-hmm. But it's wordy. Anyway, okay. That's
fine. We'll work on that.
Suggestion. Yes, Laura.
Recently, I've understood in our neighborhood there have been quite a number of mailbox entries, people stealing out of mailboxes, going down the road, leaving them open. Do you have any suggestions on how to handle that, or who, you know, what can even be done in that situation?
Yes, obviously, if you could have a secure mailbox, that's obviously the first step. Checking your mail regularly, knowing what time the mail delivery is made, and getting your mail right away. Those are some ways to avoid that. And obviously a post office box, if that's a possibility, if you're having problems, but.
Through the chair, if I may, the sheriff's office also has a wonderful neighborhood watch program, and I'm sure that they're always looking for more blocks.
That's correct. And we have three communities that have neighborhood watch programs, one on 9th Avenue, San Benito on 10th and 14th at Marsh. And each have over 100 members in those groups. So,
wow.
Yeah.
That's your area, right?
Yeah, there are three Neighborhood Watch organizations that are covering the area between Marsh and 5th. And that's 1,100 homes where people have been offered the opportunity, and it's been promoted.
Yeah, and it's a great presence, and it's ever growing, too. So.
It was brought to my attention that there was a shooting near Northumberland about a week ago.
That's correct.
Can you give any details? Or?
It's still under investigation at this time. Mm-hmm. It was a drive-by shooting.
And, a drive-by.
Correct.
Okay.
And one person was shot.
Okay.
But
kids?
It's still under investigation.
Oh,
yes.
Okay. Can you say if there were kids or adults, or you can't even say?
I can't.
Okay. Question. I had a question. Over the months, we've seen high numbers of parking violations for cars that don't move on cleanup days. Do you have that statistic?
I don't have that statistic, but
okay.
I could get that for you and
okay.
prepare that for you.
That was something that was brought to the council's attention. That there were a lot of tickets given out on the day that the street sweeper comes out.
Okay.
So I'm just wondering if that's what the status is on that.
I'll check on.
And what we might need to do to give more information to North Fair Oaks about how they need to move their cars, you know, because those are like $40, $50 tickets.
Yeah, I can check on
expensive.
That and report back to you
yeah.
on that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very
You're
much.
You're welcome.
What's the like most common robbery if it's it's not much residential as it is? What's the most common for us to kind of
what I discussed, the personal robbery or the street robbery.
Okay.
That's trending, and that's what we're trying to combat with our street crimes team, extra patrols, and the use of the gang task force and gang intelligence unit.
Are bikes still at the top of the list?
I don't understand your question. Your bikes?
Are bikes still being stolen at the top of the list as robberies?
No, it's been cash and cell phones as of late.
Yeah, what I was wondering. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I had a quick question. Is there any way that I can get some information on youth arrests here in North Fair Oaks?
I'm sorry, can you repeat?
Is there any way that I can get information on youth arrests in North Fair Oaks? Like information on that somehow?
We typically don't divulge juvenile arrests.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
I'm sorry, what are you looking for, Diane?
Like what's
numbers or what are you looking for?
Yeah, numbers.
Well, we can get numbers.
Yeah, you can get numbers. Yeah.
So that's something then we'd like to request.
Okay.
What's the status of juvenile arrests mm-hmm. in North Fair Oaks? Mm-hmm. Is that what you're looking for?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I don't know how, I mean, we're already into August, so I don't know how easy it is for you to go back on the stats.
I can look at year to date.
Maybe something we may want to include on the reporting.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Help us with like just making sure we try to engage these youth a little bit differently for us to use the data. I think that's most important for us to use the data and to share it to our organizations locally.
Yeah, that's good. Good idea.
Very,
thank
very
you
good.
Very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think no other changes, correct? We're going to go back on item number 4. And that's a presentation by ACOM regarding the Middlefield Road redesign. Hello there.
You guys hear me okay? So, hello again. My name is Christoph. I'm an engineer with the Department of Public Works, and I wanted to thank you for your time and allowing us to give you a update on the Middlefield Road Street Improvement Project. We've been working hard over the last month, and we're ready to implement your vision for the road. We are still in the early stages of this project, so this presentation is to kind of give you a better understanding of the process and what we're going to see. So as we have it, the presentation is going to go over and leverage the work that has been done to date by the North Fair Oaks Forward team and the community council. We'll be going over the goals of the project, the funding source. At the last meeting, we requested some more information on the project team and organizational charts, so we'll be going over that. Then we'll have Millette, who's the project manager from AECOM, come up and go over the types of improvements we'll be discussing, the schedule, and then Steve from Shared Spaces will come up and go over the outreach plan, and then we'll end with a question and answer. So one of the ways we're approaching this project is to build on the work that's been done by the North Fair Oaks Community Council and the North Fair Oaks Forward team. We know that a lot of effort has been going through to create the community plan and to incorporate the recommendations from this community plan. Because of your hard work, we can now move forward with the project. In order to do this, we are built a complete team. We understand that Middlefield is just one of the projects in your community plan. Our goal is to make sure that with the help of your council, the North Fair Oaks Forward team, and working closely with other departments, we can leverage all the work that's being done in the community. We understand that changes to one part of the community affect the other parts, so we want to keep that in mind during our design process. We are currently working or plan to work with the various work groups that have been established in the area. So this includes the zoning and parking work group, public art, and I believe we're in the process of building a business sustainability work group. So there have been several goals that have been outlined in your community plan. While we didn't list all of them, we tried to summarize some of the overlapping goals in the various chapters or the ones that were repeated. As you can see, some of the goals include improving pedestrian facilities and provide new facilities. So this includes sidewalks, street furniture, tree, preserve local motorized vehicle access and while encouraging slower speeds through the area, creating a more walkable, bikeable, and connected community, and then improving travel and transit connections that are safe, accessible, and convenient. So we'll make sure to keep all these goals in mind as we go through our process. In conjunction with these goals, we are working off of a adopted configuration. So this probably looks familiar to a lot of you. This was the recommendation that you provided to our Board of Supervisors and then was adopted. And while this is not the final layout, this is the configuration we'll be working off. What I mean by that is the sidewalk dimensions, all the dimensions of the various aspects of this will change or may change as we develop the design. Another part of this is the funding. So this is funded by Measure A funds. So Measure A was a 10-year half-cent sales tax. On July 9th, 2013, the Board of Supervisors approved $12.3 million for this project that'll be distributed over 4 years. And finally, to go in a little more detail on our design team, we did have a brief introduction at your last month's meeting, and we wanted to kind of provide you with an organizational chart on how the AECOM consultant team, as well as the county and all the major stakeholders, will play into this role. So we decided to have AECOM come on board through the request for proposal process. We had two of your members during the review of this process, and AECOM came out unanimously on top. AECOM was selected because they had a very strong team and had lots of experience. Along with AECOM, they brought in world-class leading sub-consultants to help them with various aspects of design. This includes the undergrounding of utilities, public outreach, and the landscape architecture of the project. Because this is such a complicated project, we do have a lot of major stakeholders. As you can see from the org chart, North Fair Oaks Community Council, for the at-grade crossing, we have a lot of entities, which include the Union Pacific Railroad, Caltrain, Sandtrams, and CPUC, which is the California Public Utilities Commission. Another challenge is we have a Hetch Hetchy waterline crossing that runs through the project, so we're going to have talks with the SFPUC, which is the San Francisco Public Utilities Commission. We also have to start conversations with local regulators for the environmental process, so this includes the Water Board and all the California Fish and Wildlife agencies like that. As well as we want to have a heavy presence in the community. So we do want to involve the North Fair Oaks community, the business community, and residents. So now I'd like to introduce Millette, who is the project manager from the AECOM team, and she'll go over the types of improvements.
Hi, everyone. I'm glad Christoph summarized our team. Hopefully you remember us from last month introducing ourselves and our theme being we were the complete team for a complete street. But I want to talk a little bit tonight about Christoph highlighted and mentioned some of the goals that the project has. And I'm going to talk about the many types of improvements that we can consider during the conceptual design process, and I'm going to talk about them in terms of the above grade improvements, the at grade improvements, and the below grade improvements. So above grade improvements that we can look at and consider during the conceptual design will be if there's interest in adding landscaping, greenery, street trees, opportunities for public art, and we want to make the area more walkable and friendly to pedestrians. So we're looking, you know, another option is the wider sidewalk option, as well as creating spaces for the community to gather. And there's some photographs there representing some of those elements. At grade improvements that we're going to consider would be, again, to improve safety, crosswalks. We'd be considering pavement treatments that may highlight those, make the area more aesthetically pleasing. Similarly, for bike lanes, we want to delineate those, make those safer for the users. And as we mentioned at our previous presentation last month, we consider the community our co-planners, and we're going to use that input from the community and help sift through all these options that we have as alternatives and improvements that we can incorporate and develop a conceptual plan. We know that constructing these improvements will be disruptive, but we'll work with the county to minimize these impacts, and developing a staging plan will be part of our detailed design after the conceptual phase. But we want to mention it here to note that we understand the significance and the concern of this community, of the community in this area, and that as the design advances, we'll be coming back and discussing this in more detail. The Middlefield Road streetscape project is about a half a mile long, and it extends roughly from the railroad crossing to Fifth Avenue. And there are have been other improvements in this area that are both in development and have been completed. And I'm gonna wanna kind of put those in context with this next exhibit. The Middlefield streetscape project is shown in the teal color there, and it, that's the half a mile that I was talking about. And at the south end of that, it abuts with the phase one project that was completed by the county a few years ago, which was a streetscape project and an undergrounding project. And we'll have similar improvements for phase two. And then at the other end of our project is what we're calling phase three, which is a county and city undergrounding project that's just starting off by identifying what the boundary limits of a utility underground district would be. And then lastly, we have this City of Redwood City project that's shown here in the brown, that's furthest to the north. And the limits of that project are from Main Street to Woodside Road. And some members of our design team are currently working on that. That includes RHAA, our landscape architect, as well as Shared Spaces, our public outreach. So we're gonna have some firsthand input on the status of that project as this phase two project advances. The project schedule, I wanted to review this a little bit. We're beginning with creating the conceptual plan, and that started in May and is continuing throughout this year. And then at the beginning of 2016, we'll move forward with the detailed design of the project. But we're obviously still in this create the conceptual plan area or phase. And during that phase, what we hope to do is develop three alternatives based on input that we receive from the community. And at the conclusion of that task, have an identified preferred alternative. Some of the tasks that we have already are ongoing. We're completing our field surveys, and we also have conducted all of our traffic counts. We hit the ground running right when we got our notice to proceed, and was able to do those all before the schools let out in June. And we also are doing our utility research, reaching out, getting as-builts from existing utilities, and starting to work closely with PG&E as we work toward the undergrounding of the project. And lastly, we are working on our community outreach plan. And as you can see on this schedule, we have shown that there are going to be six steering committee meetings that are shown in the orange circles on this schedule. And then we're planning for three workshop meetings. And those are, a lot of those are occurring now this year in 2015. And Steve is gonna go over those in more detail, but we do have others that are sprinkled throughout the project as the design advances and that we can continue our check-in. And I think I'll turn it over to Steve then. Thanks.
Oh, thank you, council members, for having us back. And I wanna say that for us, this process begins and also ends here. So as long as you'll have us, we imagine that we'll be back every month, at least to provide the most immediate information. And I want to thank the four council members I've already had a chance to meet with individually, Alora, Linda, Esperanza, and Beatrice. And I look forward to meeting with each council member, because we recognize that if we want the community to create this project, that begins here in this room. Clearly, and I know you, for you as well, it doesn't end here in this room, and that we'll want to reach out to the entire community. And so really the goals of our participatory planning process are, and I believe council members, you have this chart in front of you on paper as well, so you'll be able to see it clearly, and I'll have some expanded slides. But really, the goal is to make sure that a representative cross-section of the community makes all the key decisions that then lead to the alternative plans, actually creates those alternative plans, and then chooses amongst them. And what that really means is, at every step of the process, not just choosing amongst the results, but actually creating the foundation for the plans, creating the plans, and then choosing amongst them, the community is leading that process. And we, for us, that also means that at every step of the way, the council is involved. So in a moment, I'll outline the phases of this project. And while at the council's behest, we're organizing in a parallel fashion, and then bringing a result to the council, we want to make sure that the council's still involved at every step. Even if the council members yourselves aren't on our steering committee, that you're still aware of everything. So when the final result comes here, it's something you'll be already very comfortable with and know very well. So where we start, and which is where we are right now, is doing individual meetings with a representative cross-section of the community. So this morning I was over at the adult school, and then I was over at Shoe Club and got some shoes actually, but also hung out with Alex. And then didn't get my hair done, but I was at Danielle at the Glamour Salon. And that's what we're doing now and what we'll be doing up until September 9th when we have our first steering committee meeting, which is continually expanding that tree of people who are involved and would be very interested in hearing from council members, anyone you think who might play that role, someone who represents one of the many circles that makes up the community, because we want to bring all those circles together in our steering committee. We'll have a first steering committee meeting on the 9th of September, and then a first workshop on the 30th. And the purpose of this first phase is to answer the key questions that will underline the project so then we can create plans. We don't want to create plans and then see if they match. We want to answer the key questions together first. So we'll be posing those questions to the community at workshops because we see, while we're technical experts, these are questions for the community to answer. One level of those questions is, well, how wide, in fact, should everything be? How wide should the sidewalk be? It makes a huge difference whether it's 8, 10, or 12 feet. You know, how wide and where should the bike lanes be? How wide should the lanes of traffic be? So we have a configuration to work from, but those details of how wide each thing are will change your experience, and we want you to understand the options and make the choices. Another really important level is all the amenities that will go into the project, because almost all of them are trade-offs with other things. So for say, we could put in a second row of trees to create more shade, and you've seen that in many communities here on the peninsula. That's a trade-off with some parking spaces. So there's not a right answer. It's a question for the community to decide. Do we want to give up X number of parking spaces and get X more trees? Similarly, you might want speedier bus transit, which often involves creating a bus turnout. So a positive thing, but it also takes a few parking spaces. Again, it's not a right or wrong, it's a balance. We don't want to make those decisions because they're not technical decisions. They're questions of what you want for your community. So that's another level of key question. And then a third level is really, what character do you want for your street? The last thing we want to do is help you design a street that could be somewhere else. And if we do that, we feel like we failed. We want to help you design a street that could only be here, could only be in North Fair Oaks, and could only be Middlefield. So figuring out how to do that is that third level of key question. So that's what we're doing in this first phase that will be done by September. Then in the second phase, which will involve two steering committee meetings and a community workshop, what we'll actually be doing is creating plans based on the community's answers to those questions. And we don't want to create just one plan, but we want to create three. So the steering committee will meet and distill everything that the community has said and try to create three plans. And we have no idea what those alternatives might be, but maybe there's a plan that focuses on bike and pedestrians, and there's another one that focuses on traffic flow. We don't know, but we need the community to direct us what's going to define the different options. then the steering committee will take those options back to a second workshop where everybody in the community can assess them, refine them, add to them. And then with that second round of input, it will go back to the steering committee where the steering committee will actually vote to choose one of the plans as the preferred plan. So out of the second phase, we'll frame the alternatives, refine them, and then the steering committee will choose one. And then the third phase, after this workshop is when the plan comes back directly to you as the community council for you to review it, decide to either approve it or return it for revision. You as really the first and fundamental representatives of the community. And if you decide to approve it, it then goes to the Board of Supervisors, the ultimate authority in the county to do the same. But importantly for us, we don't want to have a process that brings you a preferred plan. So you'll see all along the side of the diagram, while we're not obliging you and we know it's important that the council remain, in a sense, neutral until the community has spoken, we want to make sure that each step of the way, after each of our meetings, the council is hearing what's happening. Hopefully you'll be there at the meetings, but even if you're not, you're hearing what's happening, giving us input and direction, and we're taking it back. So that by the time we come here in, I believe it will be your January meeting, hopefully it's not boring, but it will be close to boring because you'll know exactly what's coming because you'll be involved all the way. That would be our goal, that there will be no surprises because this will be a plan that you've been part of creating. So we want to make sure to have time to answer all questions, but I'd say I also would love to hear both in during the public portion and afterwards any suggestions for members of the steering committee, any innovative suggestions for mobilizing the community. We're going to do comprehensive mailings. Our steering committee members are going to recruit people. We're going to use all forms of media, from social to the old school knocking on the door. But we also need help. What's really going to get this community out? And then also, we're still looking for the perfect places to have our meetings. We love the community center, and we've actually, with the help of North Fair Oaks Forward, reserved this room. But we all know it's not perfect in terms of its location. So we're still looking for that perfect home, and we'd love input and advice on that too. So let me pass it back to Christoph.
So again, I just wanted to thank you for the time and the opportunity to present this to you. And now we can open it up to any questions that you may have.
Okay. Laura? Just regarding this first meeting, which is in 2 weeks, I'm sorry I missed what was the process for getting people to that, and who are you looking to come to that?
Sure. So the intent is not is representation, not size. So it, like all of our meetings, they're public, and we, you know, of course, the whole process. But what we're looking to do is find at least one individual that represents every sub-community that makes up North Fair Oaks, all age groups, cultural groups, kinds of businesses, interest groups, sub-neighborhoods, right? And make sure that they're all represented. So don't worry that we might already have somebody. Maybe we do, but it's always good to have more. Exactly. So, and the way we're doing it is entirely and intentionally through one-on-one meetings, because we want to make sure that everybody is actually committed to participating through the whole process and has the background. So you wouldn't naturally hear about us doing it. But again, please don't assume that we've talked to everybody, because you always find, oh, you mean no one's told you about this person, right? So anyone you think of that they should be on the steering committee, they're the best representative of this group, please, you know, let us know. And is our information on one of the handouts? It's on the news. It's even better. One of the many forms of media, with the help of Ellie, Jennifer, Ashley, and Pat, you've seen this special edition of the NFOF newsletter, which includes our contact information, both Ellie and I's. So if you have any ideas on potential members, please let me know.
Okay, so council members, you can email Steve. Yeah, your info's right here at the bottom. You can email Steve if you have an idea, if you want to suggest a person, pass them the name, phone number, email, and let he can do the follow-up. But if you think that person's going to be helpful on the committee, and it's the time, are you asking people to do, like, what kind of a commitment?
So the commitment, where
time-wise.
So we're going to have 6 total meetings, 3 this year, 3 in the next calendar year. Okay. They're going to be Wednesday nights at a time decided by the council. And so we're talking about 6 2-hour meetings over the next 16 months.
Okay.
That's, it's a pretty reasonable commitment, particularly if you're talking to people. We're actually going to build this. So it's kind of exciting. We're working on something that's going to happen, which is the rare opportunity.
Yeah. Okay. Any questions?
Is it just adults or is it teens and youth?
Very much so. Teens and youth and precocious 7th graders. So for real, you know, we've had some really good middle school students on other steering committees. Yeah. And Raphael, I had in my notes to follow up with you, so it would be great to talk. Cool. We already actually had one meeting, one-on-one meeting there at your center with some local residents who are going to be involved. So.
I just had actually a question about where it's the Middlefield Streetscape Utility Undergrounding Projects. I see phase one complete, then you went to phase three, but you left phase two out on the undergrounding?
Phase two is this project, which is this.
No, but it's not on here.
Oh, so the word underground
is here. Yeah,
okay.
Left it off.
Okay. All right, so yeah, it's streetscape and undergrounding for phase two, both.
Okay. All right.
But according to phase three, it's just undergrounding.
That's correct. Phase three is just undergrounding. Phase one was both as well. And the City of Redwood City project is also going to be both utility undergrounding as well as streetscape. And with that question, if I may have opportunity, I did miss one of my slides about the below ground improvements, and that's one of the things that I did want to highlight was that utility undergrounding is part of this project, which you know, sometimes the improvement ends up under the ground and you don't really get to see it, but what you're not going to get to see is all of those overhead utilities going underground, and it really will improve
and
the aesthetics.
I assumed that's going to happen first. Is that correct?
Yes, it will. It okay. will naturally need to happen first because we'll be having to build utility trenchers, and you want to get that all done before you okay. do any street improvements.
Questions ever?
Is it known what is the time lapse between phases 2 and 3? Or are they just...
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure phase two is definitely in the beginning stages, and phase two obviously is this one, but phase three is just getting off the ground, I believe, with defining the boundaries only for the utility undergrounding. So I don't know if you have any more on the schedule.
No. We can check with our contact. We have a staff member attending all the Redwood City meetings, so I can check with her and get back to you guys on their timeline, on their undergrounding.
Are you asking about Redwood City or the phase three project?
The phase three here.
Okay, so that's
it's the count to join.
Right, so.
The reason why I'm asking
sorry.
Is because the time lapse.
And the reason why I ask is because the time lapse between phase one and, you know, the current phase has been pretty long. So I just, you know, was wondering if, you know, the time lapse would be similar in this case.
No, it'll be much more closer to our phase. So we're a little bit ahead of the phase three, but it'll be within, you know, maybe a year of each of them. But we can get you a more concrete timeline.
Thank you.
Go ahead,
No, that's it.
I have a question.
I just want to mention one thing about phases, because we're talking about how phase one being done, and like today I was hanging out with folks from the adult school. So certainly I think people appreciate the improvements that have been done from 5th to Atherton, but we certainly have higher ambitions than what was done there, and we imagine you do too. So it's complete, but that's just so no one thinks we're not trying to do what's there. We're hoping to do something that's much more a better experience for everybody and also much more expressive of the neighborhood. And I think that's our collective challenge. And then hopefully they'll say, hey, wait a minute, we want it down here. And then phase 3.5 will be going back and finishing that.
Okay. Mary?
So I have a question. How do billboards play a role in this redesign?
So that's not in our scope of work. I think that's more of a policy issue with planning. We're not really addressing that with our project.
Irving, do you have on the policy side?
Will they stay up? Will they go down?
I mean, you know, this is only like in regards
to the street. Yeah. To streets, not
yeah, on the streets and the you know, utility poles. So,
okay.
And obviously the presentation next in terms of the neighborhood mixed use and you know the next steps are going to be taken. So,
yeah, I don't think we've finished the discussion about billboards. The last time we brought it up, there were some options that were thrown out, such as buy the person out or whatever. I mean, there were different alternatives. So it's something that we continue to bring it up because it's not a finished issue.
I was going to add just real quick that the streetscape project is typically limited to like the face of building to face of building. So it's within the public right of way and we're not going outside of that.
I just want to add that this is really important for our community, the design process. We really appreciate it. Because you know the simplicity of it can be really explained to a sixth grader, seventh grader, all the way up to a senior who you know can really. I think having the pictures too when we get there will be really important. So just I really like the design process where we're starting. So good work.
Thank you.
Look forward to working together.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, I we'll also tag on to that good organization. Thank you very much. And no other questions? I think, did you want to say something?
Nope.
No, okay.
Thank you, and we look forward to coming back next month.
Thank you for your time. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay. So remember, if you have ideas of people who would want to make that kind of commitment and be good on a steering committee, send those referrals to Steve.
I'll call you, too, to ask for them, so.
And I know. I had a question. So you're continuing to meet individually, right?
Yes. Yep.
You're still doing that?
Yeah, 100%.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, next thing on the agenda is the recommendation regarding the proposed neighborhood mixed-use zoning regulations that would apply to properties along Middlefield Road from 1st to 8th Avenue, consistent with the North Fair Oaks Community Plan, and we have Will Gibson presenting. Oh yeah. I think I'll get this piece in place.
Just a layer.
Good evening, council members. Again, I'm William Gibson with the Planning and Building Department. I'm here with my colleague, Brian Albini, over there, to present on the proposed updated zoning for Middlefield Road between 1st Avenue and 8th Avenue, what we're calling the neighborhood mixed use or NMU zoning. We have briefed you pretty recently on this project. We were here last month, and I believe we were here a few months before that. So I don't want to go in too much detail into the background and history of the overall process of the rezoning, but I do want to start with just recapping some of the information in brief that we did present at those prior meetings. So this rezoning is the first phase of multiple phases of rezoning in North Fair Oaks. As you can see on the map here, this phase from 1st to 8th on Middlefield is phase number one. That will be followed by the area along El Camino Real, subsequently Redwood Junction, and then the industrial areas around Spring Street and Edison Way. The schedule for that rezoning process is also shown here. It's anticipated to take approximately 2 years, ending in 2017-2018. And each of those phases of rezoning is intended to implement the land use changes that were incorporated in the North Fair Oaks Community Plan. The community plan was adopted by the Board of Supervisors in 2011 after several years of community process and community input. And it, in essence, lays out the community's vision. Among other things, it lays out the community's vision for the physical redevelopment of North Fair Oaks over the next 25 to 30 years. The plan incorporates a wide range of land use policies, and I don't want to go into a great deal of detail on all of them, but in essence, they can be summed up in principle as the statement here, and this is taken from the community plan. The plan supports the community's vision of North Fair Oaks as a complete, vital community with an appropriate mix of housing, employment, and services to meet the needs of North Fair Oaks residents. So this phase of the rezoning and all phases of the rezoning are intended to implement that vision. And as you know, zoning lays out the rules for development, for construction on any given property in North Fair Oaks. Essentially, zoning takes the broad land use goals of the community plan and refines them into a very specific set of rules that address the height of buildings, the bulk of buildings, the size of structures, what residences and businesses are allowed to be created, and in some cases, even the design of structures, the character of structures, the design of public and open space. So the zoning is really a key step in implementing the vision of the community plan, and also we are required by law to update the zoning to be consistent with the adopted community plan. So as I said, this stretch of the rezoning is Middlefield Road from 1st to 8th Avenue, and the plan's goal for that, and Brian is going to talk about this in much more detail in a moment, but is for essentially a moderately scaled mix of residential and commercial uses that is not too dissimilar from what already exists on Middlefield Road and is also not unlike what the zoning already allows. So the rezoning of this stretch of Middlefield Road in conjunction with the redesign of Middlefield that you just heard about is intended essentially to maintain and enhance the character of the street, to make it safer and more accessible for all users, but to maintain its nature as the main street of North Fair Oaks, oriented locally to the diversity of needs that the community has. So as the council knows, we've been working for over a year with a work group made up of community residents, including a number of the council members here, to draft this updated zoning. We have, after that process, finalized the zoning draft, which you have in your packets. The work group has approved that draft, and that is the document that we have before you today. Brian is going to talk in much more detail about that document, about the key components of the new zoning and how it differs from the existing zoning.
Thank you, Will. Thank you, members of the council and county staff for attending. Again, to recap, the stretch of Middlefield Road is from 1st to 8th Avenue. Aside from the triangular block to the south, bounded by semicircular 6th Avenue and Middlefield, the majority of the neighborhood mixed-use area is one parcel deep with typical 50-foot frontages. The goals outlined in the community plan envision this area to be medium-scaled, as was mentioned before, that were typical to serve the community, mainly to have commercial on the ground level with an added layers of residential uses above. As was mentioned before, the existing C1 NMU zoning and its subsequent NMU zoning is very similar with minor changes, with the scale and density and height significantly not changed. Those three key changes were building height, the mixed use designation as by right with the new NMU designation, and parking. The increase from 36 to 40 feet is minimal, and the existing building stock does not reach those current limitations. Mixed use is allowed under the current C1 and FO designation, but with the use permit, we are allowing that by right. And for parking reductions and some limitations for business uses, and also exploring opportunities for shared parking among businesses based on variability of peak activity. The last three slides I want to talk about are the actual zoning changes and some new expanded definitions that don't currently occur under the C1 NFO designation, changes in use, and uses that'd be disallowed. So for new land uses that aren't currently defined are farmers markets, and as defined as a state-certified farmers market program, small indoor exercise and leisure facilities. These could be small dance academies, yoga and martial arts studios, fitness centers, child care centers, and educational facilities that specifically serve the local community are another new use that have been expanded and its definition changed. Following that, these are current uses that are allowed under the C1 NFO designation, but now will require a use permit under the NMU zoning regulation. So those are personal convenience services, beauty parlors, hairdressers, pet sales and grooming, liquor stores and bars, community centers, and specifically ground floor residential will require a use permit, as it does now. But the mixed use with commercial at the ground floor is again a use by right. And finally, these are the disallowed uses that are currently allowed under the C1 NMU NFO designation and that will be disallowed under the neighborhood mixed use. And those are industrial cleaning establishments, mainly large-scale chemical dry cleaning facilities. Businesses that are only specialized in delivery service, funeral homes, and finally motor vehicle fuel sales and service stations. And I want to talk a little bit about what a non-conforming use means to businesses that are currently operating under the C1 NFO designation that will not require them to cease operations or close. However, it does establish some limits on expansions, relocations within the new NMU designation, and any conversion, and a conversion to a permitted use of the non-conforming use if it's abandoned for a period of 18 months or more. And with that, if there's any questions, I invite you to contact the Planning and Building Department or direct any questions to the offices of NFO Forward, and I'll pass the remainder of the time to Will. Thank you.
Thanks, Brian. I just want to emphasize again, as Brian described, and as I noted before, and I'm going to talk a little bit about some other issues in just a moment, but I just want to emphasize that these changes are minor. The future phases of the rezoning will have some much more significant changes, but the NFO plan and this zoning do not envision significant alterations to the allowed uses or the scale of uses on Middlefield, but rather just an enhancement of the character, a revitalization of the businesses, and again, in combination with the redesign, more accessibility and more safety for the current users of the street. So before we close and before we make our recommendation, I would just like to talk about a few things that, one of which did come up earlier, a few things that are not included in this phase of the rezoning. The first of those is billboards, and we talked in much more detail about billboards at the last council meeting. We will be working on a strategy to potentially remove some of the billboards or all of the billboards in North Fair Oaks, and we will be coming back to the council with information on that going forward. We'll be working with county council and with other partners to do that, but that's not a zoning issue. It'll go forward in parallel but independently of the zoning, but we will be working on it. The second is how and whether to regulate chain stores in North Fair Oaks. There's been quite a bit of interest from the zoning work group and from other community members in potential regulation of that. And that can be a zoning issue, but it's one that's larger than just this phase of the zoning. So we'll be looking at a strategy that maybe covers more of North Fair Oaks. But again, we're very much in the initial stages of that. So we're going to be coming forward to the council both to update you, but to get input on how we should proceed with that. And thirdly is the question of community benefits and ensuring that new development in North Fair Oaks provides benefits to the broader communities, in particular the benefit of affordable housing. And again, that's a strategy that is broader than just this phase of the rezoning. We will be working on that very seriously, and we already are in discussions with some of our affordable housing partners and some other policy partners on how we should approach that, how best to do it, and how we can implement it, and where. But we'll be coming back to update you on that process as we move forward as well. So those are issues that we are working on, but we'll be working on them on separate tracks as we go forward. The rezoning will go forward independently of those. And another thing I just wanted to touch on, we were before the council on July 23rd. We've been before you several times before, and we've had other outreach opportunities, but the most two recent ones were the last meeting of the council. We did take comment both from the council and from the public, and subsequent to that, we did go to the community with a public workshop on August 5th. We took comment and input at that public workshop as well, and I just wanted to note that we did receive quite a bit of input, but it was all consistent with what was already in the draft plan. It didn't require any changes, which is encouraging, in fact, because the version that you saw and the version that you have now are very, very similar. There were no significant changes that came out of the public input opportunities.
That's good.
It was good, actually. Well, we were encouraged with that as well. So finally, turning to the process. To orient this away from the speakers, I think. The process for the updates to go into effect, it must be reviewed by this council, it must go forward to the Planning Commission for their review, and then it must go to the Board of Supervisors for their adoption. So, and then it becomes effective 30 days after the supervisor's adoption. So on that note, staff's recommendation is that the North Throwks Council, acting as representatives of the North Throwks community, recommend to the Planning Commission that the Planning Commission recommend the Board of Supervisors adopt the updated zoning for Middlefield Road between 1st and 8th Avenues, replacing the existing zoning and implementing the vision and goals of the North Throwks community plan. With that, that concludes our presentation, and we'd be happy to answer any questions you may have. Okay. Thank you.
Council members, this is a we are taking action tonight on this, so this is your time to ask questions or point of clarification, information. Okay, so if there are no, do you have a question? Okay, because if there are no questions from council, I need to ask the public if there are any public comments. No? Okay. All right. So if we have enough, I will say before I entertain a motion, I'm very confident about this. I actually did work on the committee as Laura and others. It brings the whole vision of downtown. I mean, it just is going to bring that to life. To life and to light, and that it keeps the character. That was over the last, 5 years or so, that's been one of the main points, that whatever we do keeps the character of the Middlefield Road merchants. And it's not to drive anyone out of their business, it's to, I think the word you used, Will, was the revitalization. Is to enhance and keep that character, make that area a downtown district. The combination of business and housing, you know, we need housing. We want to bring in more business. It's good. But I don't get to make the motion. I will entertain a motion regarding this.
Could I just add a comment to that?
Sure.
And this is just to thank the Planning and Building Department, because they have been meticulous and very patient about it, and we certainly appreciate your thoroughness and your helpfulness in helping us to understand all these issues.
I would like to move that the Council recommend that the Planning Commission recommend the adoption of the NMU zoning regulations as they have been presented tonight and worked on by the work group. And yes,
okay, wonderful. Is there a second to Laura's motion?
I'll second that.
Okay, thank you, Diane. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? No. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? So that's unanimous. Okay. All right. Thank you very much, Will and Brian and all of your staff, Lisa, for helping get us to this point. I know there's more to go, but at least we got to this point. That's excellent. Thank you.
Yes, go ahead.
In the earlier presentation, there was discussion, I'm sorry they're not here, about a work group on business sustainability. And I know that, I think that they may be framing that in terms of just during the construction process. And I would hope that it has a broader implication and intention that that work group help us with the process that you were just talking about of business sustainability in the neighborhoods. Yes. Right.
Okay. Next agenda item, recommendation regarding off-street parking exception, and the location is 628 8th Avenue. And this is to allow one tandem uncovered parking space to be located in the existing driveway and within the front yard setback. So Brian, you're presenting? Okay.
Hi, good evening, members of the council. Again, yes, this is another off-street parking exception in North Fair Oaks. Here's the parcel location along 8th Avenue. And I wanted to kind of get right down. This is associated with a room addition and the conversion, actually the replacement of a once illegal one-car conversion from, I believe, the late 1940s, and is now proposed to return it back to a one-car garage. This is the view from the street along 8th Avenue. This is a portion of 8th Avenue where the right-of-way, the actual paved road and right-of-way extends into the property area, and subsequent photos will show a lot of it's gravel, and there is ample street parking in this particular area of North Fair Oaks. Currently, this is from the project proposal where 2 to 3 cars are parked outside of the parcel. Again, this is from Google Street View, and you'll see the house is set about 20 to 30 feet back from the edge of the paved road and is outside of the property parcel. And shows ample space for 2 to 3 parking spaces. Their off-street parking exception is inside beyond the white picket fence in front of the converted garage, which will be replaced back with a single car garage. The area in orange indicates their proposed off-street parking tandem space and their proposed correction of that illegal conversion of the original garage back to a one-car garage. This is the elevation of the project as it stands now, and this is the proposed replacement of the single-car garage as it originally stood. And I ask a recommendation to approve the project and the proposal for the off-street parking exception.
Is there another addition is this part of something else, or is it just?
If you'll permit me to go back, the original site plan shows an addition of a rec room into the rear of the property. That's outside of the scope of this off-street parking exception, but mainly it's the correction of this garage back into the original one-car garage. The regulation has changed sometime in the mid-60s to require 2 parking spaces for this level for more than 2 bedrooms of a single family dwelling. And so in order to be in compliance, they're asking to consider the tandem space in the front yard setback.
So it's not triggered by any other thing. It's just they just want to make that garage back into a garage that
exactly
looks nice. That's
what, and they want to be back in nice compliance.
But that's unusual, isn't it?
Yeah. No, it's good they can do that. My goodness. Council members, any questions on this? Okay. Any public comment on this agenda item?
Can you give a little bit more information? Because I'm working on this project.
I'm sorry, we can't hear you.
He's going. Sherilee Farrell is working on the project.
Yeah, so I'm here.
Okay.
There are a couple of corrections actually to the description on your document. The parcel is actually 4,450 feet, not 5,450 feet. It was surveyed about 2 months ago. It's not a three-bedroom house. It's a two-bedroom house. It will remain a two-bedroom house. And all they're doing is complying with the setback.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. I'll entertain a motion. No, we already did that. There's a recommendation to accept the proposal. Is there a motion?
I move that the council recommend approval of the off-street parking exception on this behalf. To be up to code on the location being 628 8th Avenue in North Fair Oaks.
Is there a second to the motion?
I second that.
Okay. Any further discussion? Right, we saw that. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Ooh, we're getting through. Okay. So, supervisor's report. Irving. Yeah.
Good evening, council members. My name is Irving Torres. I'll be reporting on behalf of Supervisor Warren Slocum. I just wanted to provide a couple of updates tonight to the council. First of all, just a reminder that there's going to be a redesigned flood park meeting that's going to be held on Tuesday, September 1st, 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. Three alternatives for the redesign is going to be presented, and then the people that attend will have the opportunity to vote on the three preferred alternatives. So I just wanted to remind the council to make sure to attend. Another update that I wanted to mention
Excuse me, Irving, where is that meeting?
Oh, sorry. It's going to be at the Fair Oaks Community Center from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. on Tuesday, September 1st. The second update I wanted to provide to the council tonight is next Tuesday, the Board of Supervisors will be considering allocations of $20,000 towards the Redwood City School District's Familias Unidas program. That's going to be going towards the Fair Oaks Elementary School. So that's going to be presented to the Board of Supervisors next Tuesday for consideration. Another update that I want to provide to the council is next month, as you know, the Board of Supervisors have been looking at, affordable housing, and they're actually assembling an affordable housing task force that's going to be representatives of mayors from all throughout the cities of San Mateo County, CBOs, housing developers, apartment realtors, education, labor, and so forth. And so that meeting is going to be in September. And so next month, I'll provide more information regarding the task force, the meeting, and so forth. So another update that I want to present to the council is on September 19th, Supervisor Slocum's office, along with Human Services Agency, is going to be hosting a free citizenship workshop. It's a free workshop that's going to help those who are eligible and want to become U.S. citizens apply. As you know, the naturalization application fee is $680, but those who are under certain criteria are eligible for the $680 to be waived off. And so we're providing an opportunity for those to come to this workshop to have the free waiver application be waived, and also get assistance through attorneys. But we're in dire need of volunteers to kind of help us, coordinate the event and to help us throughout the whole process, because it's going to go from 9 a.m. to about 5 p.m. So council members, if you're interested in volunteering, we're going to be sending out an email to all our nonprofit agencies, all our neighborhood organizations. So hopefully the council, you can help volunteer, and so it'll provide more information on what you can do to help out as well. Oh, so
when is the training for that?
So the training is going to be set in 2 weeks. More information is going to be in the email that I'm going to send to the council. Okay. So there's two set dates, one in Belmont, and I think one at the Fair Oaks Community Center too, but we'll get more information. I'll provide that information tomorrow when the email's sent out. And so that's going to be on Saturday, September 19th. It's going to be held at Sequoia High School. And then the last item that I wanted to mention to the council is, let's see. So it's just in regards to the public comment that Oscar made in regards to 855 Barron Avenue. So I wanted to kind of give an update to the council with that. So there's a total of about 50 units at this trailer park that has a lot of like code violations. And so there's going to be inspection on September 9th. And so ideally, hoping to get some information. They've actually reached out to Rebuilding Together to see if there's any way that Rebuild, it's a nonprofit organization that helps with these kinds of matters, to look at how and which way Rebuilding Together can help out. There's also been some issues. There's right now it's in the process. As I mentioned, September 9th is going to be the inspection. So hopefully next month I'll provide more details and kind of next steps at our office, along with Rebuilding Together and several other agencies who are working to help these families out. So I'll provide more in details next month in my report.
So it's only there's repairs that are needed to get them out of a violation?
Each unit's going to be different from my understanding, and so hopefully this September 9th inspection will provide more details in terms of each unit and what kind of, I guess, violations, if they have violations or not.
And he said there's 150 children?
That's what Oscar mentioned. I'm not sure the
50
total.
50 units.
50 units, yeah. Okay. 50 or more
Linda,
units.
Linda, that sounds right.
Yeah, really? Okay. And don't forget on your list of resources, PG&E, they do that also.
Sure.
You know, the weatherization, the, fixing, what do they call that? Home repair. I don't know what the regulations are for mobile homes. I have no idea. But, and also, if there are seniors there, then they qualify or disabled. Center for Independence, mm-hmm. CID, also will do. So there's a lot of agencies that have these programs, and depending on who the population is, there's going to be some additional referrals there for you.
Sure, and we'll keep on updating the council in terms of next steps at our office, along with the several agencies who have been helping the residents off.
Yeah, for someone to come to a meeting here and to, present a problem like that, it's a huge concern. And I'm sure they're fearful of, not having a home.
Sure,
so,
yeah.
And I would think it's very time sensitive, so this has to happen quickly, correct?
To my knowledge, that's kind of the fear that's, these residents have in mind. And so, we're working quickly as possible, obviously, with Rebuilding Together and other agencies. And as I mentioned, we'll provide more updates next month.
Yeah, I know it's
meeting.
Code enforcement, but it sounds like an urgent something that needs to be expedited. So I would ask council members if you have any other ideas for referrals or agencies that can help out. We're going to send to you, Irving?
Yeah, please feel free to send me an update. And then also there's conversations that there's going to be a group meeting I'm coordinating with Mary Martinez with the Fair Oaks Elementary School to kind of host a site meeting for Rebuilding Together to kind of explain in terms of programs and what they can offer. So as soon as we know what date that is, I'll send it to the council as well. So you're more than welcome to attend as well. All right, thank you. Any more questions or?
Any other questions for Irving? No? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Council.
Thank you. Okay, so North Fair Oaks Forward report.
Alrighty, good evening, North Fair Oaks Community Council, county staff, and members of the public. My name is Ellie Dahlman, and I'm here with Jennifer Logia on behalf of the North Fair Oaks Forward Outreach Team to provide you a brief update of some of the work that we have been doing.
Good evening, Council. As Ellie mentioned, my name is Jennifer Logia. I'm with the North Fair Oaks Outreach Team, and thank you for your time today. I'm going to start things off with a summary of our Dine and Dialogue series. We had our third Dine and Dialogue event on August 12th, and I want to thank those of you who attended. That was actually the last Dine and Dialogue for this summer, and here we have a quick summary of the entire series. In total, 65 people attended the Dine and Dialogue series, and at each event, we collected evaluations at the end. Our responses showed that 90% rated the information as useful. 90% agreed that the event provided a comfortable environment to share opinions. We also asked attendees to share what they enjoyed most about the event, and that included the interactive nature of the small discussion groups, as well as the opportunity to speak directly with NFO council members and community and county representatives. They also shared suggestions for future dialogue topics, including affordable housing, parking solutions, education, transportation, the environment, art, culture, and voter registration. Overall, we felt that we had a really positive outcome from this effort, and we hope to continue the dialogue series in the future.
And I just want to provide a brief update on the public art projects that have been going on. So we are very excited to announce the completion of the North Fair Oaks Entry Sign Gateway project, with vinyl lettering as the last touch to complete all four of the entrance signs. We have pictures here that are a little bit hard to see, but please keep your eyes open as you're driving around your community for the signs. We look forward to celebrating the public art accomplishments thus far on Saturday, October 3rd. So please write that date down and mark it in your calendars. We will have more information for you very soon. New projects the work group is working on include a mural, which you have heard about near the Fair Oaks Elementary School. We're still in the process for that project, as well as possibly looking at a fourth county-owned utility box on, I believe it's 5th and Waverly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I just got another suggestion today to...
Great, yeah.
Place,
yeah, so also for the council members, if any of you have suggestions around future projects,
yeah,
please... send me an email or give me a call.
I said we're just going to do a list, right?
Yeah.
We'll add it to the list.
Exactly. Okay. And then briefly touching on the business sustainability planning that was mentioned earlier. So as you may recall, when the conceptual design for Middlefield Road was approved by your council, you requested a business sustainability planning effort. And we just want to provide we don't have much to update on today. We are in the research phase for that planning effort, but we are looking at business sustainability planning that will occur before construction begins, during construction, and moving forward after construction. So it won't be just during the Middlefield Road redesign project.
So, Ellie, I have a question.
Uh-huh.
How is the work that you're doing, and you started working with the merchants on and the vendors on Middlefield Road, how is that work going to be mixed in, or collaborating with Steve on his piece? I'm just curious, what's the distribution, or how are you both working on the same thing?
So we have been meeting regularly on a weekly basis to make sure that we're all on the same page, so that Steve and his team is able to leverage all of the work that has been done to date by the North Fair Oaks Forward team. So I know on the steering committee there is representatives from the business community, which is one of the many groups that he's looking for representation from. But we will be working closely with Steve and his team, and we will be providing more of a support role as during the Middlefield Road redesign piece.
Yes, of course.
Just to follow up on that, will this
Will the two of you then also be working with Will on that piece that relates to chain stores? Because to me, that's a big part of the whole business sustainability in the long term.
Yes. So the North Berwick's Forward Outreach team works very closely with all of the county departments, including planning and building. And really our role here is to ensure that the community is engaged in all of the changes that are happening, including looking at chain stores, billboards, et cetera. So we will be very closely involved with that process with the planning department.
Yes, those were two items that did come up loud and clear in the community meetings we've had.
Yeah, and actually add parking to that, because that's also an issue that has not been fully resolved. There are some suggestions and proposals, but it's not completely resolved, and I don't know if it ever will be, but I would guess that you're also going to be working on that piece. Is that
yes.
correct?
Yes. We are very much aware of the challenges around parking throughout the entire community, and that is one of the priorities of our outreach team moving into the new year.
Good. Great. Okay. Any questions for NFO Forward?
We've got a few more updates.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were done.
I'm just going to quickly give a zoning update since we've already heard a lot about that tonight. As you know, we had two opportunities for public input during the phase one process, and moving forward with phase two, we plan to continue having similar opportunities for public input. Right now, we're currently in the recruitment phase for the phase two zoning work group, and we hope to plan to start meeting in early October. And phase two is the area along El Camino. Irving already gave an update on the Flood Park meeting, but here's the flyer just for your information again. And lastly, we're currently planning Parking Day, which is an international event happening on September 18th this year. It's an event where we temporarily transform a parking space into a temporary park. This year, we're planning to have three events along Middlefield Road on Pacific Avenue, 3rd Avenue, and 6th Avenue. So more information on that to come, but we hope to see you all there.
Do we get a sneak peek on the park?
On what the park will look like? Right now, I don't have anything for you, but I'll be sure to let you know when we do. And that concludes our update for this month. Thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, no, I missed it last time. I wrote the date down.
Okay, great.
Thank you. Any questions?
I do have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
I was wondering about the public art welcoming sculptures. Is illumination planned for them or not? I mean, I've seen them.
Yeah.
They're beautiful. But I saw the one on Middlefield and 8th at night, and it was hard to see at night. So I was wondering if, you know, that is part of the plan.
Yeah, currently we don't have any plans to put any sort of lighting around the entrance signs, but that is something that, you know, the recommended by the council, we could discuss with the public art work group and look into.
That's a good idea. We didn't talk about that on the mm-hmm. art work on the
yeah,
art
well, group. I guess, you know, it's wow. something that we didn't think about, but
like
now that I see them, yeah, it's hard to see them at night. Which would be nice to see.
So yeah, put that on your list.
Yes, thank you for the suggestion. We will look into that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Regarding the artwork, I know it's beautiful. It's easy to clean in case they graffiti on it.
Correct. So on all three utility boxes and all four entrance signs, a clear anti-graffiti coating covers all of the art pieces that have been installed in North Fair Oaks. So if there is any sort of issue with graffiti, we'd easily be able to remove it with a specific solution.
I almost got in trouble with a couple of guys last weekend that they were with spray cans already
oh.
to So I said, I'm going to call the police right now. And they chase him around.
Wow.
So I'm saying, I mean, they're very costly.
Mm-hmm.
And it's...
Yeah, so they do have the anti-graffiti coating, so that will make it very easy to remove any sort of graffiti that goes up. But we do, and maybe the lighting could be another opportunity to kind of prevent any sort of issues when it's dark out.
I meant to ask you, when do you anticipate the mural being completed at the...
Fair Oaks Elementary. So we, because it's on private property, we need to put together an easement agreement with the property owner and present that for consideration by the Board of Supervisors. So as soon as I am able to get that item on their agenda, once that's approved, I think we'll be able to begin the process of putting out the call for artists and having the work group review any applicants and then have your council make final approval.
Okay. Where exactly on Fair Oaks?
It is at 2890 Fair Oaks Avenue. It's actually, it looks like a two-story warehouse that is literally right abuts up to the elementary school. I think it's actually, the parking lot is on one side of your office and that building is on the other side. But it would be, yeah, I can send you a picture also. To help.
Just go out like Fair Oaks.
I forgot that street. Avenue. What's that, that street?
Corner. I don't remember.
I used to live there. Oh my God.
Fair Oaks in Hampshire?
Huh? Yeah.
The corner of Fair Oaks.
Fair Oaks in Hampshire. It's actually a large gray building that has had issues with graffiti in the past. So the property owner is very excited about having a mural installed there.
Good.
What business is that there?
So it's called Trapline Products. I believe they create like animal traps or like gopher traps in that building. It's not really a place where the public comes to, you know, for services, but I believe that's what they do inside the building.
Any other questions?
Because we're so secretive.
No? Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. Seeing you weren't rushed this time, you could just relax and do your whole report. Last thing on the agenda, council members, this is your time to, if you have any reports that you want to, comments or meetings that you went to or anything, pretty much.
Okay. Oh, that's right. Last night there was a meeting at the Siena Youth Center that was about the apartments that will be built through St. Francis Center right there in front of the center, and there must have been about 100 people that came out, the residents, the immediate residents. It was a very lively discussion. There was a breadth of different questions that were asked and answered as best as that could have been as the presentation went along. But I found it very interesting because a lot of the immediate residents came and they passionately talked about while they are in favor of affordable housing, as this project goes further, there will be displacement of some of the residents who live in the area where this apartment complex will be built. So that also came out in this meeting. There will be further meetings on this topic, but I found it very interesting because it's a dilemma that is being felt all over the county at this point.
Okay. I had something to bring up. I serve on the San Mateo County Housing Department community, we call it HCDC, Housing Community Development Committee. And the committee is, and I'm actually on that committee representing North Fair Oaks. I want to encourage other council members to join me on that committee. I believe we have, there is a seat on that committee. The committee meets only during the budget cycle for San Mateo County. So it kind of starts in October, we meet in November, and then we go, the whole budget cycle for the county is what, July 1 through June 30th of each year. So the committee has the task of reviewing applications for housing, new construction, revitalizing old construction, some community service programs. So the committee's responsible for reviewing applications and making recommendations to the Board of Supervisors on what projects should be funded. It's a really good opportunity to learn about that part of the county. So I encourage anyone who might be interested, please contact me. And maybe, because we're going to start up pretty soon, aren't the next cycle. And maybe the first, maybe this year you can just sit, you know, and observe and see if it's something you want to get into. But it's a good opportunity to learn about housing in San Mateo County. And on the committee, you have representatives from all the entitlement cities in the county and other commissions on there. So it's a really broad representation of the county. So anyway, I just wanted to throw that out there because I've been on that committee for so long, but I'm on there by myself. Now that you are all here, we need to get some other, I need someone on there with me. That's what I need. So if you're interested, let me know. Okay, thank you.
All right, I got some announcements. For any community leaders that would like to speak to the community at Siena Youth Center, we're starting our first parent action team meeting on Tuesday, September 8th, 2015. This is a team that was established 2 years ago from the Siena Youth Center community, hashtag family. It's very exciting to be a part of this group. It's around 30 or sometimes 50 parents that get together every other week to talk about things that are happening in the community. Second, the North Ferox Youth Initiative is accepting applications for this upcoming school year. If you know any youth that are interested, I believe ages 14 to 22, have them apply. They can find the applications on Facebook, CNYC.org, or just simply by stopping by the Siena Youth Center. And thirdly, I'd like to just thank the council for being a part of the festival, that we were, you know, honorably invited by the sheriffs. They treated us amazingly, so I just thank the sheriffs for that. It was great to have the team together and just really resource people at our booth. I thought it was really fun to work with you all, just to share our vision and our mission and also our passion for the community. I think that it goes a long way to be there. So I just, you know, think it was a great moment for us to share our leadership and to give a kid a sticker and say you're a leader. That really, truly inspired me and, you know, made me realize how important we are as role models in the community. So I thank you all.
It was hot, but it was fun. I mean, it was super hot. Everybody was like melting. I wanted to, just on what you're saying, I'm reminded that we collected a lot of names, emails, phone numbers. So what are we doing with those? I hope that they're going into some kind of a database that can be used to, as part of your outreach, to not only bring people here, but to get them involved in the community.
Our booth was very popular.
That's good to hear. As far as the emails go, we do have an email distribution list where we distribute all of our newsletters, including the special edition newsletter that you all received today. That will be going out tomorrow, as well as information about any community meetings or events that we have going. So we will be adding those emails to the list.
Oh, good. Awesome. Okay, great.
So we got you a lot. That's good.
Great.
Okay, any other report backs or
general comments? No?
Oh, I was just going to add on to what Rafael said. The deadline for the Youth Initiative application is on Tuesday.
Oh.
I don't know what day that is, but...
Is that September 1st, right?
September 1st.
Okay. And, okay. And, oh, you two have started school, right?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'm glad you're both here and everything's going great. Okay, I think that is it for the meeting. I will just entertain a motion to adjourn.
I second.
Okay, so there's a motion. Well, I can't motion. So okay. You want a motion?
I motion to adjourn.
And is there a second to a motion?
I second the motion.
Okay, meeting is adjourned. Thank you everybody for coming.